Okay, so this is reel three of Child's Play, and this is May 15th, 1994, in Albion, California.
During our stay in Berlin, something intensely interesting happened. There was a huge rally held in Berlin to welcome Mussolini, who was paying a state visit. And we went down to see the entrance and the drive along unter den Linden of the two dictators standing up in the back of a car. And we were within hand grenade distance. If only we'd have had that simple little instrument, we might have altered the course of history. However, it was a most exciting time, and to look back on, we were very lucky to have seen those two together as such important figures in history. We came back after Denmark. We came back to London. This was in the late 1938. Beginning of 1939, so it was very few months after this that World War II broke out. And at that moment, all theatres were stopped, were closed out, because no large crowd was allowed to gather in one place. So theatres were closed for 6 weeks. And at the end of 6 weeks, they realised that bombing was not going to be all over the place, but they opened the theatres again, and we were able to go on tour with the show. And it was during this run of the show that I got my calling up papers. I'd had a medical and asked if I had a preference for the service I'd like to be in. So I said, yes, I'd like to be in the Navy. So there was a wait of some months. I'd been found to be fit, A1, and a wait of some weeks elapsed. And just as I was going on the Monday night for the show we were in at Norwich, I opened up my little envelope that had come from the government, and this told me that I was now to report to a recruiting, to a centre for recruits on the following Thursday, about 3 days. So we didn't know what to do, but thankfully, my brother was not working, so he stepped into my place with the three loose screws, and they carried on. I was assigned to a chemical warfare unit, and I thought, well, that won't be too bad. I shall probably be in laboratories and things, and working in a white coat, and testing tubes, and what have you. But it didn't turn out that way. Chemical warfare was very hush-hush, and so I didn't find myself in any white coat at all. I found myself working at night time only, way out on X-4, freezing to death, and testing these weapons by stealth, in fact, so that nobody knew what we were doing. However, I heard about a new War Office project that was taking place, and they were going to take all the professional actors and actresses in the services and put them into a pool of artists. It was called the Central Pool of Artists and run from the War Office. And we were going to be sent out as entertainment units, and we were going to be called Stars in Battle Dress. So I wrote to this organization. I got a letter back from the sergeant in charge of the entertainment units, and lo and behold, it was an ex-agent of mine. So the letter said, we'd be delighted to welcome you into the fold, and my transfer was applied for, and within a few weeks I was in London as part of the Central Pool of Artists. And from then on, for the next 4 years, we did nothing but go around. Before the invasion started, we were taken round various places in various commands. There was Eastern Command, Western Command, Northern Command, and each area had a party. party consisted of 7 artists, and we did a 2-hour show. And we were in the army. We carried our weapons and our blankets and packs and everything around with us. And we were assigned a lorry, an army lorry, wherever we went. And we had our own piano. And we would arrive at the command, at a center. For instance, the Southern Command was in Norwich, I believe. And the entertainment officer would meet us, give us a little list of camps we were supposed to go to on each night. And he would allot a driver and a lorry to us. And we got all our props in baskets and trunks, loaded them onto the lorry, took them to the camp where they were told we were coming, and they built a little stage for us. And we did our performances. But there were some very funny moments. Too numerous to recall, really, but some of them were very amusing. In my training battalion, I had been rushed here and there by various people, but the most disliked man was the drill corporal, who used to drill you on the square and shout at you at the top of his voice and tell you what idiots you were when you didn't do a thing right. And he was gimlet-eyed. In fact, we called him Snake Eyes. His eyes were really drilling through you every time he looked at you. Well, the funny story is that some weeks after I joined Central Pool of Artists, I was put in charge of our party, and I was made up to sergeant, top sergeant. And so it was only just a few weeks after I'd left the training battalion and left Snake Eyes doing his shouting at other people, that we arrived in that selfsame camp to do a show. Well, I was fitting out the lights and putting our own footlights in and lighting, and I was on the stage, and I looked up, and coming down the center aisle was Snake Eyes. And he looked at me with those terrible drilling eyes, saw that I was now a higher rank than he was, so he couldn't shout at me. And he just turned tail and walked out of the theatre and didn't come and see the show. Another thing was that when you were in the army, talking about clothes make the man, when we changed for our show, we were in civilian clothes. And everybody, as you were a civilian, and they were surrounded by army and army personnel, as you were in civilian clothes, they called you sir. They didn't know your rank, but they called you sir. And after the show, when you changed back into your uniform, it was, hey, pick up that and put it over there. And so we also say, clothes do make the man. One incident which I'll try to condense was that the second front was imminent, and we were sent down to Folkestone in preparation to going over after the invasion took place to entertain the troops. And we were sent down to Folkestone, and our personnel in the Stars and Bedrest came from all different units. They could be Royal Engineers, they could be artillery, they could be Remy, they could be anything at all. So when we arrived at the station, all was so very well organized that there were sergeants all along the platform when the trains came in with the troops on, and you were sent over to your unit. That is to say, if you were in the artillery, there was a group of men in the artillery, you were one of the artillery. And in this way, we were going to be sent to different parts of the station, and I had to go to the sergeant in charge and say, we are a War Office Council party, we're not split up like this. So he took my word for it, and we were sent in a 1500 weight truck to a woodland site. And the idea was that when you were allotted this site, you were given a tent for so many men, and you had to dig a slit trench against air raids. which was fairly deep, and the idea was that if the Germans got wind of the fact that there was going to be an invasion, they knew troops would be all along the coastland areas, and they'd come and do bombing raids. So if this ever took place, you had a sit trench to jump into. So my party were not going to dig slit trenches. They were saying, we had musicians with us, and the musicians said, I play a violin. I can't ruin my hands by digging a slit trench. So a lot of them had their own reasons for not digging a slit trench. So I said, don't come to me. The best thing to do is to go to the medical officer and get a medical chit to say you are unfit to dig a slit trench. Then nobody can question you at all. So one of my boys went up to the MO, and he said he went to the to wait in the queue. And when he got inside to see the medical officer was very curt indeed. And this particular member of my troop said he'd injured his wrist. So he wanted a chit to say that he couldn't dig. So the MO came around and looked at his wrist, and he thought it was such a minor incident that he was furious, and he said this is so minor, I don't know why. He said, you wouldn't come to me with a thing like this in peacetime, would you? So Jack, this particular member, said, no sir, I would call for you. And the result of that was he got 14 days in jail for insolence. Another thing was, when we got to Folkestone, we were attached to the Royal Brigade of Guards. Now, they're the smartest troops in the British Army. But we were just like a ragtag and bobtail unit, with people not being excused boots, for instance, not being able to carry a pack. There were so many things that we were not doing. We were wearing soft shoes instead of army boots. We really looked a bit sorry. And so we said, well, we can't parade with the guards. The guards are so smart. So I got a hold of the sergeant major, regimental sergeant major. He was the top sergeant major. And I said, I must see the commanding officer and tell him all about this, because if we parade in front of him, he'll drop dead. So I went to see the commanding officer, and the commanding officer was a very fiery Scotsman, red-haired, very fiery indeed, and he wasn't going to have any truck with concert parties. So I said, well, we're a war office concert party. He said, I don't care what you are. He said, as long as you're in the Guards, you're a member of the Guards Brigade. So I thought, well, that's a great start. However, the regimental sergeant major was very kind, and he put us right at the tail end of all these guards' companies, the company of guards, going on to this huge field to be inspected. He put us right at the end so that we would not show up as much as the guard units were doing. So when this fiery officer came along, he was looking along our ranks, and he just couldn't believe what he saw. And so there was one boy who had his, he was a coloured boy, a Negro, and he, one of our party, and he was, had his pack on the ground, and he was wearing pencils, and he had a funny little twitch, and he got a chit from the doctor to say he was suffering from tic douloureux, which is a nervous twitch, or a complaint with a nervous twitch. I'd never heard of it before. However, when the commanding officer came round, he was questioning people, and he questioned one boy who happened to be in his own regiment, the Gordon Highlanders. And this member of my party was also from the Gordon Highlanders, so he thought he'd get sensible answers from him. So he said, oh, and what's your history? And the boy, instead of telling his regimental history, he gave his theatrical history, and the blood rushed to the commanding officer's face, and he just couldn't believe what he was hearing, and went on to another man to see if he could get any sense out of the next man. Then, of course, he, out of the corner of his eye, he saw this Negro twitching, So he turned around and said, "Stand still, that man." And then walked on. And then again the twitching came. And in a louder voice he said, "Stand still, that man." But the Negro couldn't stand still. However, the third time he said it to the Negro, he said, "Stand still." This Negro turned round, which you should never do. You should never turn around. You always face front. But he turned round to the major, who was in another room behind him, and in this very, very American voice said, "I got a chick for the jitters, sir." This commanding officer just fled from then onwards. He wasn't going to have any more track with us at all. Well, then came the day of the invasion. The invasion took place, and several days afterwards, we were sent over to land on the beach after the others. They made a bridgehead of about 50 miles, and we were sent into this bridgehead, and we were stationed in the only town in the bridgehead, Bayeux. And we went into this town, and we were billeted on French villagers, and they looked after us very well indeed. And on the way from the beach, we were given orders that as soon as we landed on the beach, we must disperse immediately from the beach, because that's where the Germans were sending over their bombers, or their bombing planes to bomb the beaches. So you must disperse immediately from the beach and go to a holding outfit. So we were trundling up this hill, and it was very hot indeed. We had all our packs on, water bottles, gas masks, blankets, you name it, we had it on our back. And we were walking up this long hill, and a lot of the men were getting very tired on the way up, and so they were just falling out and lying on the bank side. So we got farther up the hill than a lot of people, and then we said, "Oh, we'll have to have a rest, no doubt about it." So we sat down on the side of the road, and in the distance came this little figure in a kilt. And every time he saw anybody lying on the bank side, he was livid. He said, "Get up on your feet, man. You're at war now. Get up, start." And these people got up on their feet and really started to march on. And he did this all the way up the road. Anybody that was lagging behind, he shouted at them. But he suddenly came to our party, and he looked us up and down, and he said, "Now come along, gentlemen, please." And just walked up the hill ahead of us and disappeared over the hill, and we never saw him again. I forgot to mention that just before we embarked for France, we had been asked to do a command performance for Queen Mary, who was at Badminton House. She was there for the war, the duration of the war, and we were asked to go along to Badminton House, which is, I believe, the Duke of Buccleuch's stately home. And we were told to run the show through for one of her equerries, to see that the entertainment was suitable for Her Majesty. And at one point, one of the boys lost his trousers. And it was done as if it were accidentally losing his trousers. And the one of her equerries said, "Oh no, you can't do that." So another one came in and he said, "Oh, I think it looks so accidental." He said that, "I think we can pass it." So at the end of the performance, she did a smile, of course, when this incident happened. When we asked afterwards how Her Majesty had taken it, her equerry said, "Oh, the old lady burst her stays." At the end of the show, we were all lined up for Her Majesty to come along the line and offer her congratulations and how she'd enjoyed the show. And she went along the line and proffered a gloved hand to each one of us, which was, supposedly, you had to just touch her fingers. And as she went along the line, she came to our pianist, who was basically a Cockney boy, and he didn't know the protocol. And as she offered this gloved, limpid hand, he grabbed a hold of it and shook it warmly. But I suppose that accounted for the momentary look of pain on Her Majesty's face. But we thought it was very funny when it was told to us afterwards. Alan told us what he had done. So, getting back to France, we were told to do our first show was to do a show for a tank regiment, which were just about to go into the front line. So all these tanks were lined up or surrounded a grassy area, and we had all the audience, the tank crews and things, sitting on the grass, and we drew two lorries up back to back, lowered their tail pieces, and the two tails together made the stage. And if you wanted to go off the stage and change, then you went into the lorry. So we were doing a silly burlesque number called Nobody Loves a Fairy When She's 40. And we were all dressed as ballet dancers. And we were right in the middle of this number when suddenly, from out of the blue, out of a cloud, came one of the German fighters, and he was firing his machine guns all the way along the ground. So there was a mad dash out of this field and into the nearest ditch you could get, including us. And when he disappeared into the blue, this plane, everybody sort of got up and got back into their seats in the field, and we were supposed to go on with the show. But it's a bit difficult. You look rather foolish when you're getting out of a muddy ditch, dressed as a fairy queen or a ballet dancer. So we had many sheepish looks on our faces, I can tell you. One of the perks we had in the army was that we performed to all and every type of unit: Army, Air Force and Navy, American, Canadian. To all of these units we played during our stay in France. So after we had done the show, we were always given a meal in the officers' mess, and it was a fairly jolly evening, having seen the show and any excuse for a party. There was always quite a long stay after we'd finished the show and had a meal, so we didn't get home till all hours in the morning. But the perk was that whenever we'd finished the show, they always wanted to show their appreciation and say, is there anything you want in the way of equipment? And of course there was always something we wanted. For instance, we had the ordinary British battle jackets on, which were made of very rough khaki material. So we saw that the Canadians had a very fine material for their a very fine woven material for their battle dresses and battle jackets. So we said, could we have some battle jackets and trousers? And they said, yes, of course you could. So we were taken and kitted out with the Canadian battle dresses. And then we said to another unit, we went to a tank unit, and they said, was there anything we wanted? And we said, yes, we would like blackberries as opposed to forage caps, which were very much smarter. So that was that. And then we said we wanted shirts and ties. Now, shirts and ties were not allowed to anybody other than a commissioned officer, but we got those as well. And some of the boys got revolvers in holsters. Some we got shoes. We got everything that made us look. Oh, we eventually finished up with an American unit, and they had some lovely jackets, waterproof jackets, which they put over their ordinary battle dresses, and it hid all the insignia. So by the time we were kitted out with all these units, we all looked like officers. Nobody could tell the difference between us. We had rather smart uniforms. We were wearing collars and ties. And we, in some cases, had small arms, only allowed to officers. And so when we walked along to the theatre where we were going to perform, everybody was saluting us as if we were the incoming commissioned officers. And of course, we always returned the salutes as if we were. But it was a rather unique situation. But we performed in all sorts of places. We performed in the most wonderful little theatre, about 4 centuries old, this theatre in Bayeux. It had 4 circles reaching from top to bottom of the theatre, and the capacity of the whole theatre was only about 450. So you can imagine how small this theatre was and how many people each circle held. But it was a unique and lovely theatre. And as I say, you could almost shake hands with the audience in the gallery. At the end of the... we did several shows there. And at the end of the... when the battle went forward and things were going well and the Allies were going... the Germans were retreating and the Allies were going forward, we had to leave Bayeux. So they gave us a farewell dinner, which was arranged by all the army cooks. And we had about, probably 12 or 14 guests, including ourselves. So I suppose in all, on this tiny stage, we had about 20 people seated at a horseshoe table. And the lowest rank we had at the table was a brigadier from the army personnel, other than ourselves. So it was quite an elaborate dinner for we lowly portions of the army. But then we went on. We went on to play in barns. We had stages made of army tables put together to make one big stage. They put about a dozen or 16 tables together, and that made a stage. But of course, being on grass, they were all rickety, and you never know when you were going to fall on your ear. We played to, as I say, we played to Canadians. One Canadian unit we played to, and they seemed to enjoy the sight gags, but they didn't like the dialogue. So we said, after the show, we were given this rather nice meal, and the padre came up to us and said, oh, he said the boys did enjoy the show. So we said, well, they did up to a point. They didn't laugh at the jokes. So he said, that was understandable because they're all French Canadians. And of course, we hadn't been told this beforehand. We went on to play various places where there were slit trenches nearby that you could dive into if anything happened. We had one place in which we were billeted in a house that the Germans had used as a billet. It looked like some huge nursing home or probably minor hospital. But they left it in a terrible state, and they had to go over it with a fine tooth comb to see that it hadn't been bombed or anything like that. But then came the clearing up part, and it was in. They ruined everything. They'd torn everything up. They'd smashed everything up, and so it all had to be cleared out so we could take it up as habitation. Well, in the early part of the landing, the early days, they sent over a couple of planes every morning, the Germans, to machine gun this area, because they knew we were taking up things that they'd used. So this Negro boy that I spoke of previously, he said he wasn't going to sleep in the house because they knew the people were in the house. And so he and a few others dismantled the water system in the roof of this place, and he took it out in the garden and put his blankets and things inside the cistern, and he slept in the cistern. He thought he was safe there, but of course if a bullet had hit it, it would have gone through it like a tin can. But he was satisfied that he was safe. We had people who we had a rest and recuperate area, and this consisted of a laundry unit, an entertainment unit, a cinema unit, and a cookery unit. And the troops came out of the front line, having been in there for some days, and they were in this 24 hour off or overnight stay there. They were able to have a change of underclothing, any uniform that they were lacking was replaced. They were able to have a hot bath. They were able to see a film. And then they came out to us late at night and saw the concert party. And it was one of those incredible situations where we finished the day's work, so to speak, and the staff hadn't seen the film. So they gave a special performance for the staff and the concert party. That was us. And people were coming in, and the staff were coming in, and some of them had been in the hills, and they'd found bodies lying in the hills, and they were coming back with watches they'd taken off or medals they'd taken off these bodies. And it seemed such a macabre situation that you could be enjoying yourself watching an American film. I remember the American film very vividly. It was called Roll Away Clouds. And in between this, seeing this glossy film, people were coming in having looted dead bodies just outside this tent that the film was being shown in. Very, very sad story, really, when you look back on it. But there it was. That's how it happened. We went on to do a number of things in France while we were there. We were there, I think, for about 4 months. And we went from Bayeux in Normandy, and we went right up to Antwerp, and then on to, we went into Holland for a little while, where it was terribly cold. We finally ended up in Brussels, and I think we were there about the day after, or the 2 days after Brussels had been liberated. And as our lorry went through the streets, they were lining the streets, throwing flowers at us and hanging onto our hands as we shook hands with people on the side of the road. It was quite amazing. And we were there for probably a month. And at the end of this time, they decided that they would give a gala performance for all the troops in the area, and a sort of VIP, local VIPs, Belgians. And it was in a very magnificent cinema, and we had other of the Stars and Battle Dress units in France at that time, so we all amalgamated, and we did one huge gala performance for them, and it was a great success. We had an audience of probably 3,000 or 4,000. Huge success, because everybody was in that mood of euphoria that anything was funny, anything was good. The applause was, you know, unstinted. They gave you wild applause for something which, in ordinary course of events, if they paid for their seats, they wouldn't probably put their hands together at all. But there it was a wonderful night. And soon after that, we went to the RAF headquarters in Brussels, and we did a show for them, and again the inevitable party at the end of it. And I was saying to one of the senior officers in the place, I said, "We're going back to England in a couple of days." And I said, "We've got to go all the way back to Bayeux, which was a long way." And he said, "Well, why have you got to do that?" I said, "Well, that's the only place we can go from, evidently." And he said, "Oh, nonsense." He said, "We've got transport planes going back every day." He said, "If I can get you some seats on that, would you like to go back with that?" So we said, "Oh, my goodness, yes." So we went up into Holland. We did our shows up there, and I kept on phoning him every day to say, "Well, this was our last show, and we were coming back to Brussels. You know, could he tell us if there was a freight plane going back?" And yes, up came the answer. Yes, there was one going on the following day or the day after that. And so we all rushed back to Brussels, got our kit together, got into an aeroplane, and we came back to Stansted, very pleased it was all over. We had a few weeks in London, and then VE Day came, and the war was over, ostensibly, and we were told that in Norway there was about 1.25 million German troops still there, who really didn't want to end the war. They wanted to fight on. They thought they could do something by not capitulating. But however, they did, and they were all put into caged pens as prisoners of war, and they had staff, many staff. They were briefing them as to where they came from, what they had in their kits, and if it was other than, if they were to empty out their kit, all the kit that they got, all their kit bags, and their belongings were searched, and anything that was not issued to them by the German army was quite rightly supposed to have been looted, because even if they bought it with the local money had been printed by the Germans, so it was really stolen in any case. So all the way through these camps, they'd go into a sort of run of wire fencing, and you go through the first area, and there were people there with things like petrol pumps, and they would take the man and say, take your kit off, empty it out on the floor, and they'd spray his kit with DDT, then they'd put it up his shirt and down his trousers and spray him with DDT, and then he had to gather his goods up and get out quickly, and they were going through in some hundreds a day, and so everything was in a hurry, and these men were all off balance all the time. So the next thing they went into was another thing to see if they looted anything. So having got out of the first hut and put their kit together again and put it on their back, immediately they went through another door. They said, empty your kit out on the floor, and then they took everything, watches and pens and binoculars and accordions and musical instruments which they got from the locals. And they were all stacked up in this hut and eventually given back to the Norwegian authorities to try and find the rightful owners. And so it went on. And then the last hut was the interrogation hut. And they bring these men in. And they were looking for the top brass, or the top ranks that were giving orders, not the ordinary private, but they were bringing the privates in and intimidating them, not ill-treating them, but intimidating them. And they said, would we like to stand in on one of these interrogation sessions? And we said, a couple of us said, yes, we would. And we stood behind this interrogator, and this private came in, this German man came in, and he said, looked up and very businesslike said, your name, rank, number. And the fellow said, let me look at your pay book or something. So the man puts his cap on the desk to search for his pay book inside his tunic. And of course the first thing the interrogator does is to sweep the cap off the floor. You mustn't put it on the desk. That was the idea. So the man bends down to pick his cap up and he shouts, stand to attention! And it was all this sort of putting them off their balance all the time. And so he looks through the man's wallet and he finds a photograph of this same man posing in front of a building which they'd just set on fire. So the interrogator has a whip on his desk, and he picks this whip up, and he goes round the desk to the man, and the man is scared, of course, and he puts the whip under his chin and says, put your chin up, and he says, were you responsible for this? And the man says, no, it wasn't me. Well, who was it? So they say, it was Leutnant Schmidt or somebody. So the interrogator goes back to his desk and puts down Leutnant Schmidt's name. Now at the end of the day, they get all these interrogation officers have a list of people who've given orders. Now they're the people they're looking for in this melee of soldiers. They're looking for all these people that have given orders, because they're the culprits for all that's happened. And it was very interesting, but it was terrible in one way, but interesting in another, that they didn't actually ill-treat these men, but they certainly intimidated them in every way they could in order to get information. But a very interesting session that was. Our stay in Norway lasted 3 months, and we started in Tromsø up in the north, and we rode the whole way down entertaining British troops all the way back to Oslo. After that we came home, and it was demobilization time. You may remember I spoke about George Black, who had the London Palladium for many years. Well, his son was George Black Jr., was our commanding officer in Stars and Battle Dress. So when the end of the war came, with an eye to starting his own productions, George Black Jr. and his brother, Alfred, put me under contract for 2 years and gave me leave to do a pantomime each year for another management. Well, that was great as far as I was concerned. I did 2 complete tours with George Black shows. I did 2 pantomimes, and one of them, strangely enough, was in Bristol with my brother Eddie in the same pantomime. So that was the beginning of my theatrical life again after having been in the army for over 4 years. At the end of the 2 years, I heard that they were putting out a tour of White Horse Inn again. And one of the principal parts my brother had played at one point was offered to me. So I took this part in White Horse Inn, and I was with it for another 2.5 years. And it was in White Horse Inn that I met Hilary, my wife, and soon after that tour finished, we got married, and I was a bit of a crossroads in my life then, not knowing what to do, and I had an idea I might like to work in the United States. So I went to Hollywood, spent a month over there trying to see agents, and as is usual in these situations, I was just too late. You should have been here last month. We did a picture with a whole lot of English characters in it, and you would have been fine, but you're just too late. And so it was, and I ran out of cash, and I came back home. And on my return, I was fairly seriously ill, and I was put into hospital for about 6 weeks. And I thought, this is going to be very difficult to tour. I needed to be on a diet. So I had one pantomime to do. I did this pantomime in Norwich in 1953, and that was the end of my theatrical career. I finished that pantomime, and I left the stage then. I did various other things in connection with agencies to do with theatre and modelling, but that didn't seem to work out. So life went on after that, and since retirement, life has been more than exciting. My children have grown up, and we've had all sorts of wonderful trips to see them all over the world. We've had... I'm very lucky when I think back and think that the job I had, I really adored. I really wanted to go to work and work. There was no such rubbish as overtime. If you were doing a dress rehearsal and something went wrong, you go into the early hours of the morning, and nobody ever thought of asking for overtime. They were too happy to do it and get it right, so that on the night it would be perfect. And nowadays you go into studios and they're so hidebound with the Union rules that when the time to turn off the lights for the day, if there's a shot of about 2 minutes, everybody looks at each other and they dare not say, yes, we'll do it, because it's only a couple of minutes, because the unions are standing by saying, you shouldn't do that. And so everybody closes down, and that means another day's work. Well, that wasn't the business as I knew it, and I think it's rather sad that it's come to that. However, that's how the world goes on. And my theatrical career was not very distinguished, but most interesting. And I reached a certain stage of recognition among my theatrical colleagues, if not to the general public. But it was very nice. It was a very nice life while it lasted. But just to go back on my story for one moment, in 1953, I was asked to go with a similar concert party to Korea, again to entertain troops, but this time I was a civilian, and I was sent by the War Office, who arranged these civilian shows to go out to the various theatres of war whenever it was necessary. So I went with a party to Korea. And we went out to the plane trip took us 3 days in those times to get out to Hong Kong. We went out and we stopped over in Hong Kong, and we did a week in Hong Kong doing shows for various bodies that were administrative officers for the army and their families while we were in Hong Kong. We were put up at the Peninsula in Kowloon, a magnificent hotel, and we were given a lot of comfort because we were now civilians and had to be looked after in a proper way. I was recalling the other day that we were asked to go to dinner with the garrison commander of Hong Kong. Now, the garrison commander is in command of all the British units in that area, and is in fact the Queen's representative. So we had this meal with him and his wife, a very nice couple, and they'd seen the show and liked it. And we were talking about the show, and at the end of the meal we said, well, we must get back to Kowloon. So he said, how are you getting there? So we said, oh, we're going by ferry. So he said, well, I'm going back on my boat. Would you like to have a lift on my boat? So we said, oh, yes, please. So he sends for the car, which turns up the front door. It was a Rolls Royce flying the British ensign and the British flag, and we were taken down to the dockside where there was a naval pinnace with six sailors with boat hooks ready to salute as we went aboard. We were taken aboard, taken to the other side, and the same thing happened at the other side. There were more sailors with more boat hooks and another Rolls Royce, and we were dropped at our hotel, and we were saying afterwards, what an extraordinary thing. This man, as the representative of the Queen, has given all this pageantry in his life and given all this treatment and a wonderful house at his disposal. And later on, he retires and he goes to some benighted place like Bexhill-on-Sea or somewhere. And as a retired army officer, he doesn't count for anything, really. He goes to the local newspaper shop and orders his newspaper, and everybody calls him by his first name, and they know him as the old major or old colonel or whatever it is. And he really is nothing at all, which must be very hard to swallow after what you have been and how other people see you when you're just an ordinary civilian. One of the things that I always recalled was how would I feel if that happened to me? It would feel so awful. However, we went on to Korea and we did shows in various places in Korea, all very successful. Again, to all sorts of units, to American units, to Commonwealth units, and we were the Commonwealth units were fed by the American services, and of course the food was magnificent in this theater of war, with everything around you was very barren and very hard. It was very hot in the months that we were there. It was very hot indeed, but one can get into very cold months when it is really freezing weather, and you see people walking about with babies on their backs in this freezing weather. But we were having a very nice time. We were taken to these various units by our own transport. We did the shows, and eventually we finished up in Seoul, and we were given a house to ourselves, where we stayed for some weeks. We did a couple of shows in Seoul before we came home, and that was a very nice tour indeed. But it was very reminiscent of the wartime Stars in Battle Dress, but on a different footing, which was quite interesting at the time. After our stint in Korea, we were sent back to Tokyo to do two more shows before we left for home. And I was lucky enough to find that my wife's uncle was a military attaché in Tokyo and had his own beautiful home there. And I was able to stay with relatives, so to speak, while I was in Tokyo, which was a great bonus. And I always recall how nice that visit was. We were given a farewell party before we left for the British Isles again. And as I say, we did two shows in Tokyo to the American hierarchy at that time. And it was a very exciting time, because there was a lot of activity going on then, because the war was still on in Korea. Lots of officers were there on their way to and from the war zone. And it was to this sort of personnel that we gave our shows. Great success again. As I say, in wartime, everybody appears to want to enjoy themselves. And the quality of material that you used out there in shows was not of the highest, but it was always very acceptable and always went with great excitement when a show was being seen, because they didn't get very much entertainment, but what they did get, they were very enthusiastic about. So again, that was a lovely time. At the end of that, I came home, and it was on that occasion, I think, that was probably one of the last things I did in the theatre world. Whilst in Hong Kong, I was most impressed by the local shops. There was a shop adjoining the hotel in Kowloon where I ordered some shirts and pyjamas to be made to measure. And they were delivered to the hotel the night before we left Hong Kong to fly out. And when I saw them, I was so impressed. I said to they were delivered to the hotel, not in a cardboard box, but in a cheap but serviceable suitcase, which impressed me. And not by one of the assistants, but by the manager of the emporium. And so I said to him, if only I'd known the quality, I would have ordered more. So he said, when are you leaving? So I said, well, we're leaving at 8 o'clock tomorrow morning. So he took my order, and lo and behold, at 7:30 the next day, they were delivered to the hotel, having been made to measure overnight. And that, to me, was most impressive. I had never received such service in my life, and the quality was so good that I wish that some of the British firms would pull their socks up and get weaving in this way to satisfy their customers. What a different world it would be. One incident I must recall was a theatre we played to in Korea. Showed the ingenious use of material. The staple diet, as far as drink was concerned, in this American unit we went to, was Coca-Cola, of course. And on the edge of this camp, there was a huge mountain of Coca-Cola tins, empty Coca-Cola tins. And some genius had come up with the idea of cutting the tops and bottoms off the tins, spreading the sheet out, hammering the rest of the tin out into a small sheet of tin, and then by means of a sort of French pleat, hammering them together and making big sheets of tin. And the consequence of this was that the theatre we did our show in, to an audience of some 400, the whole theatre was made up of Coca-Cola tins. But enough of this reminiscing, I must finish now, because we're coming to the end of this film. It's been nice talking to you and reminiscing, and I hope that the family enjoy it in years to come when they look at it and say, oh, there's that silly old fool at it again. Bye-bye.